Amen. With Valentine's Day taking place this Tuesday, we want to remember the greatest love, to celebrate the greatest love that has ever been extended to us, and that's the love of Jesus Christ. This Wednesday night, we're going to transition our adult power up in here from dealing with the prayers of Jesus, because we've covered them at a great length and actually just scratched the surface, even though we went to great length. And over the next 2 weeks before our Ash Wednesday service, we're going to be going through Science Confirms the Bible by Ken Ham, issues such things as DNA as evidence of an infant God, the origin of the so-called races, evidence for a worldwide flood, and several other topics that we'll be dealing with over the next couple Wednesday nights. So if we invite you to come and be a part of Wednesday nights. And I also want to say thank you. You know, Pastor Darren prayed a great prayer, and we're believing God for some great things. Be praying for Bill Collada, who is in the hospital with some heart issues. He was admitted yesterday. Some people say, who is Bill Collada? Bill and Elizabeth Collada are a new family to the church. So they've come a couple times, and I believe they're planning on making this their church home. But I got a text that he was in the hospital. I went up to visit him last night. Having a stress test today. He's got some heart issues, so lift him up in prayer. We believe in a God that hears and answers prayer. And I know that God's going to continue to do some great things. Ed McCready over here is an answer to prayer. Good to see you here this morning. Praise the Lord. Give God praise for that. Been in and out of the hospital a few different times with some heart issues, and God's working. So, yeah, it's not good to have Ed and I together, because we had caused too much trouble. So, but God is working. And this week, the reason I know that God's going to do so much more is because there were 48 different people that spent time in prayer, covering 12 hours of prayer. 48 different people, from children, teenagers, and adults. Yeah, give God praise. That's huge. We have six of those scheduled for this year, and I know several people prayed longer than their 15-minute, going over into other individuals' times. And when we get through this year, there will be over 3 days worth of prayer consistent prayer that our church has done. I think we can do more, but we're starting off small, and I'm excited about what God is doing, because we were praying not only for ourselves. We are praying for our families. We are praying for this church. We are praying for our community. We are praying for our nation. We are praying for our world. And they all need prayer. Amen? Amen? Amen. Well, this morning we're going to continue on in our series of dealing with Luke, the story of Jesus. And we're looking at Luke chapter 10 this morning. And we're going to begin with verse 30. Luke chapter 10, verse 30. So if you have your Bibles, you'll want to turn there to Luke chapter 10, verse 30. Or you have your iPads, your iPhones, or your Androids, and you have the Bible. Not playing video games, none of the Candy Crush Saga or all the other games that are out there. You know, there you go. Don't be trying to catch Pokemons. I don't know that there's any Pokemons in here in the sanctuary, but don't be trying to catch them in here. You can open up to Luke chapter 10. And also, if you have a bulletin, there's a spot for you to be able to take notes this morning. But as we begin with verse 30, just prior to that, Jesus was asked a question. And the question was, what must I do to have eternal life? And Jesus responded to that question by saying, follow the laws of Moses. What does the law of Moses say? And the man summarized and said that we are to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love our neighbor as ourself. And Jesus said, that's right. And then the man answered or said, but who's my neighbor? Who's my neighbor? And that's where we begin with verse 30, because Jesus responds. Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho. All right, he was traveling down a road that was not the safest roads in the world to travel down. In fact, if you were smart, you did not travel on that road by yourself. You went in groups. And you did not travel at night. I remember one time when I called Eric Chittister and I said, there's a situation going on. And he's like, what are you doing in that area anyway, Myron? Well, this would have been one of those things where Eric would have said, what are you doing on that road? this man was not using the wisdom that God had given him as he is traveling. It was a very dangerous road, and it's as it says, he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed on the other side of the road and passed him by. Now this priest, if he went over there to check on the man and the man would have been dead, according to the Jewish customs, the priest would have been unclean for 7 days. That would have prevented him from fulfilling his priestly duties. And so for him to go over and check on that man, it would have been an inconvenience to his lifestyle. And so rather than being inconvenienced, he left him and stepped onto the other side of the road, passed him by. Going on, verse 12, it says, a temple assistant walked over and looked at him lying there. But he also passed by on the other side. This temple assistant, or in some translation it says Levites, he was an individual that he wouldn't have been, it wouldn't have changed his work or anything, but what it would have done is if he would have went over there to check on this man, it had been known that sometimes bandits would be off to the side of the road and they would act injured or dead or something so that somebody would come up to them and check on them and then they would rob them. And so the Levite or the temple assistant, his motto was safety first. He wasn't willing to take a risk. I don't think things have changed a whole lot in our life since Jesus was sharing this story. Safety first. He wasn't willing to take a risk to reach out to the man, so he passes by on the other side. There was a despised Samaritan that came along. Now, despised Samaritan. A Samaritan was somebody that was of mixed blood. They weren't pure blood. They were Jewish mixed with Gentile blood, and their religion was mixed with Jewish religion and idolatry. And because of being a mixed race, mixed religious individual, the Jews looked down upon the Samaritans. But just because it said there was a Samaritan doesn't necessarily mean that he was a Samaritan, because it was a derogatory term that they would, because they so looked down upon them, they called anybody they didn't like a Samaritan. In fact, in John, they called Jesus a Samaritan. But most likely, this was a Samaritan individual, but it could have been just somebody they didn't like and didn't trust. And so when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Verse 14, going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day, he handed the innkeeper two silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay it to you next time I'm through. It's interesting. They looked down upon this Samaritan, yet they trusted him enough. They knew he was a man of his word, that his credit was good enough, that if the bill was higher, he was good for it. Just the thought. Interesting. Trusted him. Verse 36, now which of these three would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by the bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, the one who showed him mercy. Then Jesus said, yes, now go and do the same. Go and do the same. In your car, there's this useful little gauge that sits right behind your steering wheel, and it's a fuel gauge. And the reason it's there is because it's really hard to get out and look under the car to see how much fuel you have left in the car. whether you have a half a tank or whether it's a three-fourths of a tank or almost empty, you can't really see under there very well. You can on my Husqvarna tractor because it's got a plastic tank that you can see in and it's visible. But on cars, it's hard to see. So you have to rely up on that fuel gauge to know how much fuel there is in the car. God also has gas gauges that he gives us and uses. And if you want to know how much love you have for God, he says, look at your gauge. How much love do you have for people? If you want to know how much love you have for God, you have to ask yourself, how much love do I have for other people? It's impossible to see our love for God, like looking down under the tank, and especially the metal tanks, to see how full your gas gauge is. It's impossible to see our love for God without looking at the gauge and seeing how we treat us others. In this passage, there are four individuals that are represented. And those four individuals, they represent people today. You have the journey, the traveler, the Jewish traveler, who was in need. There are people all around us that are in need. Now, as this Jewish traveler traveled without making very wise decisions, traveling by himself, people don't make wise decisions sometimes. Sometimes they're quite stupid decisions. I've made stupid decisions. Yeah, thank you. I'm glad I'm not alone. Yeah. A few other people agree. Maybe they're agreeing that I've made stupid decisions. But I believe many of us have made stupid decisions, but how easy it is for us to become judgmental of individuals that make stupid decisions and say, well, you know, they've dug their own pit, they've got to deal with it themselves. You ever heard that or something similar? They've made their bed, they're going to lie in it now. Anyway, there's the traveler, those who are in need. There was the priest, those who know the word of God, yet are too busy to be inconvenienced by the troubles and the things of this world. Then you have the Levite or the temple assistant. He is an individual who was trying, but he wasn't sure, and so he was afraid to take risk and stood aside. And then you have the Samaritan, those who are moved with a heart of compassion and are willing to sacrifice to see that this man's needs were met. We are to be like the Samaritan. We, within the body of Jesus Christ, his church, are to be like the Samaritan. We are to be individuals that have a sacrificial heart, that are willing to be inconvenienced, that are willing to take risk, that are willing to step out with that heart of compassion and mercy and love and reach out to the least of these. Someone with a sacrificial heart is one that is willing to be inconvenienced. Someone with a sacrificial heart is someone who is willing to be inconvenienced. This means going out of your way even when you don't feel like you have the time and don't want to. Isn't it annoying to you when you go to a retail store or you go to a restaurant and those that are supposed to serve you end up treating you like you're an inconvenience? You know, excuse me, ma'am, I ordered a hamburger and it says on the menu that it has ketchup and I really wanted ketchup on it and there, I would like some ketchup. Oh, you want ketchup, do you? You want ketchup? Fine, here's some ketchup. Kind of bothering you. They're inconvenienced by us. Sorry. The ketchup just flew all over Autumn now and splashed back onto Myra. And poor thing. Sorry. Anyway, we get annoyed when individuals treat us that way. Yet how often do we treat others that same way? We're driving down the road, we see someone in need, maybe it's a flat tire, and We're busy, we're in a hurry, we don't want to be inconvenienced, and so we pray, God, would you send somebody that person's direction to help them? Maybe we were the person that God was sending that direction to help them. Too busy to be inconvenienced. You know, if we have a sacrificial heart, we're going to be willing to be inconvenienced. Why? Because Jesus was inconvenienced for us. Do you think it was easy for Jesus to come down out of heaven as God and to live in a human body and face all the challenges that you face in this life, have people disrespect him, beat him, make fun of him, pull his hair out, and then crucify him on a cross? He was willing to be inconvenienced for us because he loves us. And he instructed us to be willing to do the same for others. When he said, whatever you've done to the least of these, you've done it unto me. And then in James chapter 2, verse 14 through 17 says, faith without good deeds is dead. What good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but don't show it by your actions? Can that kind of faith save anyone? Suppose you have a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say, goodbye, have a good day, stay warm, eat well, but you don't give that person any food or clothing, what good does it do? So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces good deeds, it is dead and useless. When we're willing to be inconvenienced, we'll say, you know what? It's inconvenient to go with Pastor Darren to the rescue mission, but I'll go. It's inconvenient to go on the last Sunday of the month in the afternoon to the nursing home to love on people, even though they don't necessarily remember what you said, but I'm willing to be inconvenienced for them. I appreciate Michael Marable and his faithfulness. After Doris Powers passed away, just prior, Michael stepped in, and it's been 7 years. He's been faithful just about every month going and playing at the nursing home, and they love him. And when he's not there, Where's Michael? If I'm not there, who cares? If Michael's not there, where's Michael? They love him. And when he does that thing on the piano going across that he did a little bit this morning, they're like, oh, Michael. And then when he brings his kids, that's icing on the cake. It's incredible. And that's not in the script. And that made me, thanks a lot, Michael. Now I'm lost. It's inconvenient to get up early to come to Connect and Grow groups or Sunday school. It's inconvenient to say, oh, I'll be part of a small group, or I'll host a small group. I'll open my home to a small group. It's inconvenient to do a lot of things, but yet Christ has called us to do it. Someone with a sacrificial heart is willing to be inconvenienced. Someone with a sacrificial heart is also willing to take risk. Willing to take risk. It's been said, no one ever stubs his or her toe while standing still. No one has ever stubbed their toe while standing still. It's a risk. To get out of bed, to come this morning, you took a risk. If you would have stayed in bed this morning, you would have taken a risk. Life is about risk. If you don't like risk, well, there's one risk, you know, that you won't have to worry about. You know that you're going to die at some point in time, period. But then you face the biggest risk. If you've rejected Jesus Christ in this life, he'll reject you. Life is about risk. Max Lucado, I know some people really like Max. He wrote, God honors radical risk-taking faith. When arcs are built, lives are saved. When soldiers march, Jericho's tumble. When staves are raised, seas are opened. When a lunch is shared, thousands are fed. When a garment is touched, withered by the hand, a Galilean woman is healed. A beggar in Bangladesh is healed. Jesus stops and he responds. Taking risk. 79 years ago, Schaefer's Crossing Gospel Mission was organized. Does anybody know what Schaefer's Crossing Gospel Mission was? Not you, Steve Euler or Sheryl. Schaefer's Crossing Gospel Mission is this church. That's what we started out as 79 years ago, February 1st, 1938. Reverend J.D. West saw the need around him, and he took a risk. And he served as pastor for 23 years. 23 years he served as the pastor, taking a risk, reaching out, sharing. Because of the risk he took, people like Bobby Batten, that we just celebrated his life at the memorial service here just a few months ago, gave their lives to Jesus Christ, and hosts of others. Hundreds of people, thousands, have given their lives to Christ and been affected by the ministry of this church throughout the years. All because Reverend J.D. West stepped out and took a risk. I only have 6 more years until I get the same length of time that he was here. Excuse me, 7 more years. I'll be here 16 years this June. Wow. Took a risk. Thank you. God's good. It'll take a risk for us to raise $4,500 for the Rise Against Hunger event that we're going to be doing. $4,500. We're going to be participating in it on the 2nd of August, April, excuse me, thank you, whoever corrected me. But our goal is to raise $4,500. Pastor Myron, how in the world can we raise $4,500? You said we spent almost $8,000 more than we brought in this last year. You said there's going to cost upwards to $1,000 to fix that, and it will get fixed. How are you going to raise $4,500? God's good. He's able to. That $4,500 at 29 cents a meal will feed over 15,000 people one meal. 15,000 meals. If we have 50 people, thank you, Freddie, for doing all the math for me. If we have 50 people that give $90, that's $22.50 a week or for 4 weeks, or $15 a week for 6 weeks, which if we start the last Sunday of this month, it'd be 6 weeks until that Sunday. That would be $15 a week. We can, 50 families, we could raise the funds. $15 a week, Pastor, that's a lot of money to spend to give to help somebody, you know, feed a meal. I'm not trying to be selfish or anything, but I've got my own needs here too, preacher. Come on. Do you know what the average American spends on coffee in 1 week? That was a little high. A little high. Anybody else have one more guess? 60. Oh, that, you all are high. In the first service, they said 25. $20. The average American spends $20 a week on coffee. You say, well, I don't even drink the stuff. Well, that means people are spending even more. We're saying $15 to rise against hunger to make a difference. It's a risk, but we'll do it. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7 says, we reap what we sow. That's true. We reap what we sow. My mom ingrained that into me as a young person. She tithed when we couldn't afford to tithe. When we were going out and picking up soda bottles along the street, for those of you from the North or West Virginia, pop bottles, to get the deposits, she was tithing. When we didn't have our well, when the pump was broke and wasn't working for 6 months, she tithed. When we had our gas turned off, and we were heating water up in our little electric things to try to get some hot water and taking sponge baths with hot water, she tithed. She took a risk, and God honored her. And she continued to ingrain within us, you reap what you sow. You reap what you sow. She's in a nursing home. Some people would say she's indigent. She has nothing. She lays there in a bed. We've got a lot of the antiques, and my brother Mark has more antiques, and my brother Maurice has some other antiques. We have those things that have been passed down. My mom lays there in the bed with very little of nothing, but she has everything because she has not been storing up for herself things on earth where moth and rust destroy. She's been investing in eternity. She took a risk. That wasn't in the script either. Verse 8, those who live only to satisfy their own sinful natures will harvest decay and the death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. Verse 9, my life verse. So let us not get tired at doing good. Let us not grow weary at doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap a harvest. We will reap a harvest. If we don't give up. Verse 10, therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone. Take risk, especially to those who are in the family of faith. God has called us to be risk takers and to go out of our way to reach out and help others. A person that has a sacrificial heart, one like Jesus Christ, is willing to be inconvenienced, is willing to take risk, and number three, they're open to be compassionate and merciful. Compassionate and merciful. Colossians 3:12 says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. This means having compassion and showing mercy means even when a person has done something foolish, like the traveler had done, we should reach out to them. It's easy to justify not showing love when there is stupidity. But God has showed us and instructed us to be filled with compassion. Everyone in need is our neighbor. No matter race or creed or social background, they are our neighbor. 9 years ago, we went on a missions trip to Guatemala. Mandy went. It was one of her first missions trips. They asked her to do a medical clinic. She did a medical clinic, and Doris Powers went with us on that missions trip. So did Brian and Nancy and Buck. He looks like he's about 2 foot high. There's a picture above the sink in the well. Doris Powers was 74 years of age when she went on that missions trip. And she's like, I'm not sure, but I feel like I'm supposed to go. I don't know what I can do. We were going to build a house. And there was a lot of work, carrying bricks, making the mortar, doing all that stuff. And she's like, I'm not going to be able to do all that. I don't know what use I'm going to be, but I feel like God wants me to go. And she went. And she didn't carry the bricks and do those things. But what she did do is she prayed. And I remember when Mandy was doing the medical clinic, there was a long line of people sitting along waiting to be seen. I was playing with the kids. Nancy had probably taught me how to make balloons or something. And I saw Doris. She didn't know a lick of Spanish. And the people that we were ministering to didn't know any English. And she would go up to the ladies and she would put her hand on them. And she would begin to pray, and the lady would stand. And pretty soon there were tears flowing down both of their eyes. And then there would be an embrace. And the lady that Doris would be praying for would start rattling off in Spanish, and Doris would rattle off in English, neither one of them understanding the language, but they understood the language of the heart. We may speak a different language than the world, but they can understand the language of the heart, the compassion and the mercy that we show, are to show to them. Here's a quote that I found this week. Claiming to be a Christian, a follower of Christ, is like throwing a pebble into a pond. You can't throw it without creating little ripples. If there are no ripples, then that is evidence that there was no pebble in the first place. Our lives, when we choose to be as God has called us to be, individuals that have sacrificial hearts, that are willing to be inconvenienced, that are willing to be risk takers, that are willing to be filled with compassion and mercy, there will be ripples. There will be ripples. And so the question for you this morning to ponder, and for me to ponder, what kind of ripples are we leaving behind? What kind of legacy are you leaving behind? Will I be able to tell a story about you as I did about Doris because of the legacy she left behind? Will you be able to tell a story about me because of the legacy I left behind? What stories will people be able to tell about you? I hope that the stories that are shared are stories about my compassion, my mercy, my risk-taking, even though it's scary at times, and my willingness to be inconvenienced, even though I've had to ask God to forgive me for that many, many times, because I had been one of those people that, oh, they've got a flat tire, Lord, send somebody their way. How do you think you come up with these illustrations? God, give me a sacrificial heart that I may be the person that you have called me to be. And when we are that type of individual, it doesn't matter if we live in a senior citizen center, if we go to middle school, high school, college, work in a factory, work in a law firm, work at the hospital. If we are an individual with a sacrificial heart, people will see that there's something different about us, and we will be able to share with them the hope of Jesus Christ, because he is the hope of the world. He died for all humanity because he loves all humanity, even the ones that we don't like. Praise team is going to come, and as they come, and we wrap up this last song, if the Holy Spirit has been speaking to you, see, sometimes the Holy Spirit speaks in spite of me, or beyond me, what I say, and it speaks to your heart. If the Holy Spirit has been speaking to you, and you have been listening to him today, as we close with this last song, the altar is open. Maybe you have never asked Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sins. Now, coming to the altar does not save a person, but it's a symbolic act of saying, I kneel down and I just present this to you. I humble myself to you, myself. I give you myself. And you can ask Jesus Christ to forgive you. Maybe you here and you're like, I don't have that sacrificial heart. I need to ask God to forgive me and begin to do a work in my life so that there will be ripples that will last, that will affect people for generations. If that's you, the altar is open. When I said the Holy Spirit can speak beyond me, I remember sitting in a service. I have no clue what the preacher said, but I know what the Holy Spirit was saying to me. And if you didn't listen to a word I said this day, listen to what the Holy Spirit said. Would you stand with me? Father, I pray that you would just speak to us right now. And as we close out this service, that we will say, Lord, use me to leave ripples, to be a person that's willing to be inconvenienced, to take risk, and is filled with compassion. Thank you, Jesus, for doing it. Forgive me for my sins. May I follow you relentlessly all the days of my life. In Jesus' name.